Hi, I'm Jamie Shuttleworth and today I'm going to service a Ford Falcon 2002 Ute. So we'll go through what's on the table here. Need that to undo the oil filter. I like to use thread sealant on the sump plug and also on the diff plug just to stop it weeping. And we'll use this to undo the sump plug. The car has had overheating problems, so we've run radiator flush through it. We've already done a flush, we've already topped it up with normal water, but we'll drain the water and then we'll put coolant in there. So we'll also service the battery terminals. We've got some baking soda to clean the battery terminals, and then we've got some anti-corrosion stuff to stop the terminals corroding. We've got our oil to go in there. Ford say 5.5 litres, but most of the time the car will take 5 litres, because 5 litres will half a litre will still be floating around in the engine somewhere. But we put that in there after we've drained it, and then we just check with the dipstick and know if we need more oil. Coolant, we'll check the brake fluid. We've got an oil filter to go in. This is an anti-spill funnel for when we put the coolant in there. But we'll just lift the bonnet and we'll disconnect the battery. It's just handy to disconnect the battery in case you've got a spanner under there and you hit the starter motor wire or something. It's just handy to disconnect the battery, then you don't have that problem. Just grab some tools. The motor's been running, so the oil's hot, so the oil will drain good to conform. I'm going to take the battery completely out. So when we clean the terminals and we wash them off, we don't end up washing bits of acid and stuff into the engine bay, which creates rust. So we'll do the battery outside. When disconnecting the battery terminals, always disconnect the negative first, because if you accidentally touch it onto the chassis, nothing will happen. Same as when you connect the battery, always connect the positive first, and then when you put the negative on, nothing happens if it accidentally touches the chassis when you do it up. And this battery is a non-serviceable battery, so we can't actually top up the water levels or anything on it. But a lot of batteries you can check the water level and pop them up. And this battery's been working fine, so no complaint. The other thing we should have done before we started working on the vehicle is put some towels, which are on the bench over there, on the sides of the vehicle, so we don't scratch the sides of the vehicle. And also, if there was big scratches on the car somewhere when the car arrived in, and you're unsure what to do about it, talk to your boss and see what he reckons, and talk to the customer so you don't get blamed for scratches that were on the car before you started. Just gonna undo the oil cap, so when we drain the oil, the motor won't get airlocked and it'll drain better. Just up the hoist to lift the ute. You want to try and get it in the center on the vehicle or as far to each end You don't want too much weight front or back, because then it'll put weight on the hoist. And when you put a car on a hoist, always have it in neutral with the handbrake off. So when you go to work on things, everything's free and you can turn wheels and drive shafts and that sort of thing. And you always have to lift the vehicle by the chassis. Also, when you disconnect the battery, you can hook a 12 volt or a 9 volt thing in a cigarette lighter, so then it will remember all your code, so it doesn't reset your radio and all that sort of stuff. But we didn't worry about that because it's a pretty simple vehicle. I'm also going to undo the radiator cap, because when we drain the water, it'll stop it getting airlocked as well. So that's having to bring it back down. This hoist has automatic safety locks. That's what that noise is. So if something was to fail in the hoist, it'll pull to the... I'll pull about this far to the safety lock. That's where those sound is. Back down to the safety lock so it's not sitting on the hydraulic ram. You always try and catch all the oil and all the water that comes out of the vehicle. Now I'm pretty sure these are 15mm, which is a weird size for the trunk plug. Yeah, N18s, eh?
Yeah.
All this will fit under here. The biggest thing. The other thing is we should really wear eye protection and gloves. So I'll get them. Especially if you're under a car. You don't want coolant and oil dripping your eye. You have your PPE. Personal protection equipment. The one number one thing is try not to drop the sump plug, because you drop the sump plug and it blocks the funnel and then you get a big mess. It's a good idea to have a mesh thing in your funnel so it catches your sump plug if you drop it and stops a lot of mess. And make sure your container is always bigger than the capacity of the oil that's going to come out of the vehicle. So this will be about 5 litres, so we've got a 10 litre container, so we'll be right. Yeah, that's too good. That's my towel. Washing my hands. Yep. Let him drain. Well, that's doing that, we'll try and crack the oil filter and then undo the oil filter.
I'm just going to crack it.
But I'm not going to, I'll just crack it and wait till the rest is drained. So, the easiest way to remove an oil filter is actually have a set of oil filter sockets which fit the filters. It's the best way to do it, but I haven't got them.
What's that one called? Universal, eh?
Yeah, strap, oil filter strap. And it doesn't matter if you damage the filter getting it off, but you don't damage it putting it back on. Gotta be careful not to damage it putting it on. The oil will drip out of the oil filter normally, so you also have to have a container on it to stop the mess. Ideally you want a big tray that can catch both the oil from the sump and the oil from the oil filter. I'm putting the sump plug back in there, so I'll do the oil filter, then when I put the new oil filter on, I'll let the rest of the sump drain. Should drain your oil filter overnight and then give it to the company that takes your oil. With the oil filter, be careful. Make sure that the sealing O-ring on the oil filter hasn't stuck to the block, because if the seal's still there and you put the other filter on, which is heaps, lots of people do, you have two seals and then the oil squirts out between the two seals and leaks heaps of oil. Because the filter goes up that way, we can actually prime the filter, put a bit of oil in there, so it's less oil, the less work for the engine to pick the oil up, because there's already oil in the filter. Because on an angle, I'm not going to fill it right up, because when I tip it, all the oil is going to make a mess. Just getting a little bit of oil to put on the seal, because the seal needs to be oiled, because otherwise if it's a dry fit, it'll try and grip and it can scratch the seal, and then the seal is good. most of the time you get away with just putting the full filter on as tight as you can with your hands if you get a good grip, because it's very easy to damage the filter with an oil sort of strap. And when you take the vehicle for a test drive and that, just check for any oil leak afterwards, and that'll tell you whether your filter's leaking. Best thing to clean oil up is brake clean. Normally doesn't damage anything. And throttle body cleaner and brake clean is normally the same stuff. Biggest thing is make sure you don't get oil on anywhere, any part of the exhaust system, because that'll burn and stink, and customer might think the car's going to go on fire or something, freak out. I'm just trying to drain the rest of the oil. Not that there's going to be much to come out. While we're doing that, we'll check the diff oil, make sure that there's oil in the diff, which is normally part of the standard service. What's that? Yeah, I've got a socket there. The other thing, it's a good idea to actually, if the car's pretty dirty, give it a bit of a clean where you think you're going to be working on it, before you even put it on the hoist, because you don't want mud and stuff everywhere and you don't want dirt getting in. The best thing for undoing anything, sump plugs and all that, is normally a ring star if you've got the correct size. I'm going to use a rattle gun on this one. It's all coming out, that's a sign that it's full. So, I mean, it's all good. You can also put your finger in there. If no oil comes out, put your finger in there. See if you can feel the level of the oil. The other thing is a good idea, which I haven't done today, but quite often, if you're going to drain the oil out of an engine, pull the dipstick out, clean the dipstick and sit it on the seat of the vehicle, so then people or someone else doesn't try and start the vehicle without oil in it, because that's going to destroy the engine. Just going to put it in the thread sealant and the sump bolt. Just hopefully help it stop leaking.
Just oil for now. Have you ever filled the T-box?
No, it just leaks out very much.
Do I?
That's how the joint.
Yeah, we don't worry about that.
Yeah, no.
What we're doing.
This is ratchet.
That's the overflow. That's the overflow right there. Doesn't matter,
that's
not part of
the overflow. Don't worry about it.
Probably the torque setting for these bolts, but I couldn't find it. I haven't got the service manual. I've got the oil capacity and things like that, but you could use a tension wrench. Because it's aluminium, it is quite easy to strip. It's on the bolt. You can stop and start it if you want, because it might have to keep it far away. We're going to use this funnel for catching the water now, maybe. So I'll just run a bit of water through it. Just to have a couple of different funnels. We're going to try and catch all the radiator water, which is not easy. This is going crazy.
Yeah.
The best way to drain a radiator, should have a lot of radiators got drain bungs on them, but this one doesn't, so it's a bit messy. I've got a sump outside. Normally I'll try and catch the water in the sump and then drain the water into the sump. You could start the engine and spin the water pump over to get a bit more water out of it, but not that fussy. Be careful that you don't want to do it under a hose while it's super hot, because it'll burn you. Well, you're under the car too, just check. Uni joints. A lot of uni joints are greasable, so they're very greasy. Check for all legs. Also check all the wheels, like in the air, wheel bearing noise. Side to side will normally tell you if there's play in your steering, knuckles and things. Up and down will tell you if there's wear in your push down the bottom air and also your wheel bearing. You got a little bit of play, but if it makes a whirring sound, quite a bad whirring sound, means your wheel bearing's buggered. That's why you have the vehicle in neutral, so you can do this sort of thing. That noise has something to do with the brakes, not a wheel bearing, but might look at that later. Make sure there's nothing under your hoist too when you go down. Yeah. Just stop. Oh. We'll put the oil in here. Always have a rag handy, in case you spill the oil. I'm going to put all five letters in there. When you put oil in a car, it takes a while for the oil to get from the top to the bottom of the engine, so it reads different on the dipstick. And then we also, when you start the engine, it will suck a bit of oil in. So to get a correct reading on the dipstick, you have to run the motor just for probably 5-10 seconds, and it'll suck enough oil, and then leave it sitting after that, and then leave it sitting for say 5 minutes. That'll give you a good accurate reading on the dipstick. Thank you. top the water, reduce the water. The beauty of a no-till funnel is when the water system is full. There's two real good things about it. You can have water sitting in here, the thermostat can be closed, and then when the thermostat opens, you'll see the water go down into the engine, which is great. The other thing is too, once the system's full, that you can have the water, it's going to bleed itself automatically. You can have this overfull when you can see that the vehicle completely got the air out of the system. Then you can cap the actual funnel and take away the excess water without making a mess. Now we'll go play with this battery. Now, baking soda will neutralize the acid and remove any acid. Baking soda and water. Reason why I don't do this in the car is because, like I said earlier, if there is acid, you're washing it down into the engine bay and then it creates rust. These terminals are clean because if the terminals have acid on them, they'll bubble up. Could hose the battery off as well, but on first, and before I do that, I've got some anti-corrosion stuff, which will stop the terminals corroding. And you should wear gloves. Yep, so do the positive up, get that done. The ring spanner is the best to use for this, but this is a, I might get a little ring spanner. This is a ratchet ring spanner, so it's got a bigger end on it.
much as I can get in. What?
Make sure you always put the battery clamp on the car, otherwise you, in an accident, the battery will fall out. And you don't want battery acid to work all over you. Best to put some anti-corrosion stuff on the bolt too, because it's very common for the bolt.
You get corrosion from battery acid.
Compound. Stops corrosion. We use it on wheel nuts as well. Too tight because you can crack the battery.
Go car.
Power steering fluid while I'm at it. I can see just by looking at the fluid, but on here you got full hot, full cold, but it's full, like it's right at the top, so that's all good. And we'll check the brake fluid. Quite often you can see through the clear plastic, was dark sound as well. That's full, but I would replace that brake fluid. We won't do it today, but it's probably due to be completely replaced. We only take about 9 litres, so we're going to need more coolant. Just top off the window washing. Put some concentrate in there, and then I'll fill it up with water. You should use distilled water in your radiator and in your battery. It doesn't matter what water you use. You know what it's doing?
Just not damn water. Thank you.
an air cleaner, always blow that way, because that will not push the dirt out. If you blow it this way, it'll force the dirt into the paper, which is what you want. You want to reverse the dirt, trying to get in. Not taking any more water.
Well, do you pull this pipe off?
No.
You never do that?
No, not with that.
Finish doing this for me.
Get off the camera.
In the start of the car, just check that the oil light goes off, and if it doesn't, it's turns out wrong. We're going to hold that on.
We're all good.
Just going to check the tire pressures. The tire pressures, most cars, they're the door cars. Yep. It says your tire pressures should be 30 pounds. 30 pounds, so yeah. Just that. 30 PSI.
The pressure's been going for a bit long.
So, is that okay?
Can you turn the compressor off?
It doesn't have a...
So that says it's got 32 pound in it, which is correct. So we don't need to put any in or anything, but... You have to press the button in because that resets it, otherwise it'll give you the reading from the last tire. Yep. These tires are 32 in them, 33. When you have a car running in a workshop, make sure you've got the well ventilated because it's come off, so I'd say. Some vehicle grab a bleeder, bleed the air out. This one doesn't look like it has, but this system should bleed itself automatically. Now we've got another issue with this vehicle when the handbrake doesn't work. So we're going to pull the back wheels off, pull the brakes apart, and try and find out what's going on, see if the cable works. Check that out. I'll just turn this off.
You want me to step, press stop?
Turn on your screen.
I'll use the other rattle gun.
That one? But a bigger one?
Yeah.
The big, big guy.
Yes. I'm doing a Gwinch.
Just going to put the vehicle to my height so it's easy for me to work on so I don't have to stand down. I use this rattle gun for undoing the nuts, but I won't use it for doing them up because it's over tension the nuts. I love when that happens. Can you grab a set there, see? Just grab a set there, see?
That's not it either. Good.
Yeah, because if you put CRC on the socket, you'd probably find it'll stop it grabbing on the nut. Make it come off easy. First we'll see if the handbrake cable works, so we'll get Shane to pull the handbrake on and off, and I can see if it's moving under here. Now I'll tell you whether the cable seized or not. Yeah, that's pulling, so the cable's not seized, it releases. Either the brake shoes are worn out, or the brake shoes just need adjusted up. So. Tight. and get a breaker bar on there. As you can try and knock two stones together, get some more power. We're going to take the caliper off, so then we can take the brake drum off. Break this.
Should never put another spanner on a ratchet spanner, because it wrecks the ratchet spanner.
Quite often you can get a rattle gun in there and spend on with a rattle gun, but there's the room on this. And Ford used Loctite from the factory, which is a nice thing to do. Oh. Try uni joint on there with a rattle gun. When using a rattle gun, you shouldn't use a uni joint, because it can break the uni joint. And also, you should always use an impact socket, because it can damage an oil socket. Brake pads, don't need to replace, but they're past 50% worn. Yeah.
Just pause it for a sec.
Now I'm going to put the wheels back on there. I'm going to use a torque wrench, so I'm going to use the rattle gun to nip them up just loosely, and then I'm going to use a torque wrench to check the torque of the nut. But to get a correct reading, you need to lube the end of the nut so that it doesn't bind into the aluminium, otherwise it'll read incorrectly. And I'm also going to put a bit of anti-seize on there too, so the nuts won't rust onto the studs. So I'll do that.
Are you serious? You use grease?
Or anti-seize? A little bit to, so the threads stop the threads rusting up. I like to have the top stud straight up so then I can hold the wheel with the top stud straight up. Easy to line up. And I like to put them on by hand so you don't wreck the thread. And because I've got a nut at the top, two down the bottom, that should pull the tire evenly on. You can also spin the wheel over to see if it's buckled or not. The torque wrench is already set to 100 pound, which is in the service manual. Tension. Can you hold the other wheel?
Yep.
That clip is the tension wrench. Into its tension. It's a lot easier to do this with a bit on the ground. I normally just do them tight enough and then go over on the tension wrench when they're on the ground. This is what we're doing now. I've already put our anti-seize on all the studs. If you do it by hand too, you can feel if there's a damaged stud.